afternoon, everyone.
Thank you for joining us for the book launch of our colleagues here. If you are not familiar, this is the Knowledge Center. This is a small part of it. When Pancho contacted us, that's Pancho. He said, like, oh, I'm launching a book. And like, what is the book all about? Obviously, I'm not a scientist like you guys. But I asked him, like, a short blurb to describe what the benefits are of the book. So I'm going to try to read as much as I can. The title of the book is Vineyard Selection Indices in Modern Plant Breeding. The book represents a substantial compilation of work done in an area known as selection indices in animal and plant breeding. It also contains a wealth of material on how various types of linear indices can be constructed, interpreted, optimized, and applied. The techniques described in the book were developed mainly with plant breeding as a focal point, an area which the authors have extensive. So before I introduce the authors, we have a guest from Colpos, Dr. Amario Santa Cruz Varela. He's a professor of the Institute of Genetics at Toledo Postgraduate, which is very close, in the early year. He had his PhD, acquired his PhD in Iowa State, that really. Dr. Amario will speak in Spanish to describe the book much better than I can. Please, Dr.
Muchas gracias. Agradezco muy cumplidamente a los organizadores de este evento la invitación. Muchas gracias por hacerme partícipe de este momento de regocijo para los autores de esta obra y también para las instituciones que les dan la oportunidad de desarrollarse profesionalmente. Escribí unas notas para no perder algunos puntos importantes. Quiero mencionar que aunque en la portada del libro aparecen como autores los doctores Jesús Celón Rojas y José Crosa, cuando exploré un poco más el libro me di cuenta de que también contribuyeron con capítulos específicos otros colegas fitomejoradores, entre los que recuerdo al doctor Gregorio Alvarado, que no veo por aquí. Recuerdo también a mi colega del Colegio de Posgraduados, Sergio Pérez Elizalde, desde luego al doctor Juan Urgueño. En todos ellos yo identifico dos características muy, muy claras. La primera de ellas es su indiscutible autoridad académica en el área de la genética estadística. Esa calidad se ve reflejada en esta obra, pero no solo en ella, sino en numerosas publicaciones en revistas del más alto prestigio a nivel internacional. La segunda característica que he podido constatar en todos ellos es su gran calidad humana. Son personas de una sencillez extraordinaria. Esa sencillez inclusive raya en la timidez en ocasiones. Son ese tipo de personas con las que uno se siente pues, muy cómodo, muy a gusto platicar con ellas, pedirles un consejo para resolver situaciones cotidianas sobre el procesamiento de información, lo cual resuelven pues, sin ningún asomo de egoísmo o de pedantería. Son ellos muy sencillos. Muchas gracias por ser así. Por favor, no cambien. Sobre el libro. La obra desde luego constituye una compilación de lo más completo que hay hoy en día de trabajos que se hayan realizado sobre reseñas históricas, los diferentes enfoques que hasta ahora se han abordado en esta área. Sin embargo, este libro va más allá de una simple compilación, pues una buena proporción de este libro, los autores la dedican para vertir sus propias aportaciones y sus enfoques personales. Particularmente logré distinguir al menos tres aspectos en los que los autores han contribuido con material propio. El primero de ellos es el uso de vectores propios, o sea, los famosos eigenvectors, proponiendo que se utilicen los coeficientes del primer vector como los factores de ponderación de los diferentes caracteres, los traits que les dicen en inglés, los caracteres que intervienen en el modelo. Esto ha tenido una gran aceptación a nivel internacional. Si revisamos la literatura, muchos documentos se basan en esta aportación, sobre todo por las facilidades con que ahora se cuenta en cuanto a recursos computacionales. Estos recursos, el manejo de las computadoras, ahora facilitan la aplicación de diferentes modalidades de análisis multivariado. Es muy fácil obtener estos vectores, sus coeficientes, este corresponde acá, este a otro. La segunda aportación que yo identifiqué es que ellos lograron incorporar información molecular a estos modelos. Por ejemplo, proponen el índice que ellos llaman MESINC, que quiere decir Molecular Eigen Selection Index Method, y el GW SIM, Genome Wide Eigen Selection Index Method, como complemento a los modelos que se basan en fenotipo. Un tercer punto es de que ahora ellos proponen prescindir de las ponderaciones económicas que normalmente se involucran con estos índices y consideran a estos factores económicos como fijos. Este es un punto que el doctor Jesús Cerón empezó a desarrollar junto con el punto anterior de los de la información molecular. Desde que trabajó su tesis de doctorado, y desde mi punto de vista es un gran acierto. ¿Por qué? Porque cuando se involucran factores económicos, estos pueden distorsionar a los modelos genéticos y pueden restringir su aplicabilidad. Por ejemplo, las condiciones socioeconómicas, la apreciación de los diferentes caracteres varían mucho de acuerdo con el contexto social donde se desarrollen. Por ejemplo, en la faja maicera en los Estados Unidos, es posible que las características forrajeras del rastrojo de maíz puedan recibir mucho menos valoración económica que en los sistemas de subsistencia en México y en otros países de América Latina. Quiero mencionar también que la historia de los índices de selección es bastante larga hasta ahora. Las primeras aproximaciones datan de la década de 1930, del siglo, es decir, del siglo pasado, o sea, ya han pasado unos 80 años con estos enfoques. Esas primeras propuestas de Smith, de Hassel, incluso antecedieron a la introducción de las fórmulas de respuesta a selección que propuso Jay Bush en Iowa State en la década de los 40, para predecir las ganancias genéticas, inclusive antes de realizar las siembras. Ya sabemos cuál método es más eficiente, qué esperar de cada uno de ellos. Y yo creo que todos estamos claros de las ventajas de utilizar métodos de índices de selección. Cuando tomamos nuestros cursos de fitomejoramiento, ahí se nos demuestra de manera muy clara las ventajas, las bondades de estos índices de selección, y nos hacen las demostraciones matemáticas que procedan, y todos decimos que sí, que es necesario aplicarlos, pero en la vida real los utilizamos muy poco. Y aquí viene una pregunta: ¿por qué se da este desfase entre la teoría y la aplicación? Desde mi punto de vista muy personal, es que tiene que ver la dificultad intrínseca de estos modelos. Pues para aplicar estos conocimientos, estos índices de selección, se necesitan bases muy especializadas de matemáticas. Hay que saber álgebra de matrices, hay que saber álgebra lineal, lo cual no es algo trivial, es algo complicado de por sí, y esto nos obliga a prepararnos más en el campo de la genética cuantitativa, de la genética estadística. Entonces, desde esta perspectiva, es un gran acierto de los autores de esta obra que hayan incluido en los últimos capítulos ejemplos numéricos concretos e incluso la codificación de programas necesarios en R, pero también en SAS, y las instrucciones concretas para aplicar esos índices. Es decir, nos llevan de la mano con esto, tratan de superar esta desventaja de la dificultad intrínseca de los índices de selección. Finalmente, quiero mencionar que, desde mi punto de vista, aún quedan algunos retos por resolver. Por ejemplo, tengo la impresión de que los modelos de selección y de predicción genómica han sido construidos simplificando al máximo los componentes genotípicos de esos modelos. ¿De qué forma? Pues considerando generalmente líneas endogámicas donde se encuentran loci homozigóticos, con un solo alelo por locus, inclusive a nivel de población, solamente hay un alelo en las líneas endogámicas. Sin embargo, no debemos perder de vista de que los sistemas agrícolas que utilizan esas fuentes genéticas, o sea, las líneas, están localizadas en áreas ambientalmente homogéneas, como la faja maicera de los Estados Unidos, y que en otros lugares como México y América Latina no se visualiza aún en el corto plazo la sustitución, la adopción generalizada de maíces híbridos. Por ejemplo, llevamos alrededor de 70 años desde que se formaron los primeros híbridos aquí en México y solamente estos alcanzan una superficie de alrededor de 20%, y ahí se ha mantenido por décadas. Entonces, es procedente explorar otros enfoques e índices de selección que se apliquen a poblaciones complejas, altamente heterocigóticas, como los maíces nativos, que conocemos como maíces criollos, de los sistemas de subsistencia. Quizás un enfoque alternativo pudiera ser echar mano de los análisis que ahora le dicen Big Data, masas enormes de información que ahora están cobrando relevancia. Pero en fin, esa solamente es una opinión de alguien que no es experto en el tema. Nuevamente, felicidades a los autores, felicidades a sus instituciones por este gran aporte que ahora están presentando. Muchas gracias.
Switching English because my Spanish is obviously working. I'm going to introduce the first author, Dr. Jesus Cerón Rojas. He acquired his PhD from the same university where Dr. Amalia is working, Colpos. Having previously worked at INIFAP, he's been working in CIMIT's Bioinformatics and Statistics Unit for almost mas dekada na, like more than a decade now. His research, Dr. Cerón's research, focuses mostly on selection indices, phenotypic and genomic, selection supported by molecular markers, genomic selection, and the prediction of genomic estimated breeding values. Dr. Cerón.
Bueno, ¿por qué escribir libros sobre la selección? A mí hay otros. Bueno, acá hay otra cosa. Casi me comprometió a escribirlo. Bueno, no es correcto. A escribirlo porque a él se le ocurrió pues que poner todo esto, que no hago un test. Porque hay otros libros, por ejemplo, de Baker, pues expone la selección, pero tal y como aparece casi en cada artículo que deja. No hay un intento, digamos, de encontrar un patrón general que una toda la teoría de los hombres de selección. Ese fue el principal intento de nuestro trabajo. Tratamos de que la teoría de los hombres de selección no aparezca dispersa, no aparezca sin correlación entre ellas, sino que se vea claramente que hay una sola teoría y que todos los chingues están relacionados matemáticamente principalmente. Los chingues de esa región, los tenemos uno trabajando, por cosa yo, mencionó principalmente el doctor Mario, no son otra cosa más que una aplicación de la teoría de las relaciones genómicas a un texto que en la que ya venía trabajando Smith Cousin. La importancia del enfoque nuestro, método, nos parece precisamente lo que ya se llama Camargo también, que nos saca del complejo contexto de las ponderaciones económicas. Porque, ¿cómo asignar una ponderación económica si esta es cambiante? No es constante, sino que depende de las circunstancias del mercado, de qué se quiera producir, bueno, un montón de factores. Si sacamos esto, seguimos contando con un índice que sea tan preciso o igual que preciso, que el índice de Smith, entonces estaríamos ganando, porque estaríamos sacando ese factor subjetivo para quedarnos nada más con la metodología que el índice de esa relación. Entonces, desde nuestro punto de vista, pues, quizás por lo que hicimos nosotros, los métodos Eisen son muy importantes para el mejorador. Ahora veamos si el mejorador decide usarlos, porque si no los utilizan, van a quedar ahí arrumbados en nuestro trabajo. Pues, lo hicimos con mucha emoción, pero no va a servir mucho. Muchas gracias.
I ask Pancho to speak in English for a few of our colleagues here. Everyone knows Pancho, but I'm going to try to introduce him. Dr. Jose Croza, affectionately called Pancho by friends and colleagues. Acquired his PhD in biometrical genetics from the University of Nebraska. In 2008, Pancho received CGIAR Outstanding Scientist Award for leading the development of statistical genetic models for effective genetic resources conservation, characterization, utilization, minimizing the loss of genetic variability. One of only six recipients of CIMIT's Distinguished Scientist Distinction. He is recognized and respected worldwide for his contributions in classification and conservation of crop genetic resources. And his methods are used by specialists. Pancho.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for Richard, Paola, and you, and Jennifer for organizing this. I think that I'm going to say in 2 minutes something about the book. I mean, it's not that we decided. Let's write a book. No, it's the product of book since 2005, that Jesus came here and said, "Oh, I'm writing this for my thesis in doing the master's degree, right? Master's degree in statistics on QTS," and then we start talking about it, and he explained to me what he was doing. kind of sabuta, the same in there, about selection indices and saying there is a problem because the plant breeders don't use selection indices because sometimes it's difficult to find the weights, the economic weights. How do you put economic weights for any yield diseases? For the animal guys, this is easy, for the plant breeders, no. And so the plant breeders usually don't use selection indices up to now. I think that now you will start using selection indices because genomics, markers, and all this. So, you know, that was 2006 that we published this article in Crop Science where we said, no, we don't need weights. They said, go to hell, you are wrong. And for many, many times. And then, so Jesus advanced in this, and then Amalio was the committee of the PhD thesis, and Benitez Riquelme, and Fernando Castillo, and who else was in your committee, myself, and we published really two very good papers, one in genetics on selection indices. They say so many things to us, no need, you need to put economic weights. We say no. And fortunately, we have an editor that was Bruce Walsh, that was very keen on this. And Bruce said, I like your methodology, so let's publish it. This is one thing. The other thing was the paper we published in Jarvis 2008, where we show the relationship between the indices and the canonical correlation. That was, again, another paper where some reviewers as kill us say, you should use economic weights. These weights that you use depending by the data are not. And up to now, we have trouble to study because that comes from 1936, Smith, so, and Hassel. So that is something that in this book we try to show that the methodology that we use is working very well with markers as well as data, and perhaps the plant breeders will start using it, and I bet they will use it soon when they have, you know, when they have to use and select for green meal and protein or something. So it's not that we sit down with Jesus and say, okay, now let's write a book, and then let's go and play soccer, and then come back and write the book again. No, that was more systematic because you know, a lot of work. One thing that I'd like to mention is the financial situation of the book. That was an open access. And for open access, CIMI needed to pay some money. And so without the support of CIMI, without the support of the GRP program that helped us, and Kevin in particular, helped us to get the money from the foundation, that was a very important step because otherwise the book was going to be out of access, and the people that we wanted to read the book, it was different. And the book was published by Springer. So I think that next time we have the task will be to develop or study non-linear selection. Dan Janola on the introduction, he said, I like the book, blah, 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 but the author needs to get into the non-linear selection needs, because those are used also in animal. And I think that the book has some mathematical, some pages on the theory of that, but then the examples. And then also, the last two chapters, they have the RINCET software that was written by Sergio and Gregorio and Juan and all the guys in the biometric that developed very sophisticated, high-level software for using that. So there is now no excuse for the breeders, no excuse for Terry not to use selection index. Now, you can use selection index because you can use it using RINCET. And also, because this is important, Fernando, which is an expert in simulation, he decided to do a comparison of the different selection indices, including the ESIM, to see if there was a gain or how was the comparison between our indices with the standard conventional indices. And you know, our indices, they came out to be all right. Those the best, sometimes yes. But you can do this only through simulation. Without simulations, we say, well, you trust us. The theory is correct, but then who is gonna question the Smith? No one. And we don't question Smith because actually it wouldn't work with the Smith selection index.
You notice we don't have the physical books here. So we're not gonna get it. The spatula is cheap. Spatula is cheap. But we have the book as full open access. It's a good pilot. It's one of the first publications where it was funded by the program, supported by the program, the donors, to be open access. As everyone who publishes, it's quite expensive to have open access. And this is very important. Please. We're happy to send you links to this, and you can access the publication. This event is not just them talking. We intentionally put the chairs like this so that it's more comfortable for you to ask questions and have an open discussion. So this part I would leave to you guys. I would be happy to facilitate if you have some questions.
Who's the intended audience?
It's basically plant and animal freedom, but also in general biologists, biostatisticians, bioinformaticians, you know, to some extent, because we include markets. I guess it's the audience of the book is for readers.
So beyond university level, or would it be
it could be used, it could be used. But usually, I don't know now, but in the past, selection is not a topic at the university, at least for courses in plant breeding. Yeah, perhaps a fast mention of selection indices, but not really getting to the results, the gains, the genetic values of an individual. The thing that the traits are negative correlated with what they do, you know. The wheat breeders, they suffer a lot because they breed for grain yield and protein usually goes down, as well as in maize other traits.
So I understand that you're saying that selection indices are
not
cool, but they want to get it from you. But the problem with economic ways, I mean, economic weather is right around me from season to season, from month to month, they change. Grain prices were very high 10 years ago, now they're very low. So how do you handle that problem in the book about economic weather? Well, that's one of the challenges. Why do three that don't use a selection indices? Is what way do you talk about for the economic weather? How do you handle that problem in the book?
Yeah, usually we have experience with the SUS, with Joseph and Dan Makumbi in Africa, where they said, do a selection index using these traits and this location. And he said, you want to have a weight, or you want us to? He said, no, you put these weights. Diseases, some number. Grain yield, another number. Of course, if you put grain yield 10, a weight of 10, and disease is 0.01, then everything will be dominated by grain yield. So that's good. That is easy to guess. But usually they put a way, something that they think it will reflect on the final decision, that this trait has to be given more emphasis.
So it's really subjective.
Was subjective. We couldn't have done it, and we did it when we do use the Jesus method, the ESIM, Eigen Value Selection Index. we put a weight of one to everything. And then we develop the methodology and we change the weight and we put the coefficients that are coming from the mass. But this is just, this is a
I think that also we can think that we are not using different traits in the index. We can use the same trait, like clean yield, in different environments. We can have clean yield in low nitrogen, in drought, in heat, in optimum, random drought, or we can build an index using only clean yield. We don't need a less economic index. And we have a way to weigh the different environments. This is an important application, I guess. Not in the standard class in which you use several traits.
Yeah, that's true. That's correct.
Kevin?
Yeah. I'm wondering, in addition to open access, what is your strategy to increase and maximize the impact of this work?
We have I myself and also Susk has distributed the you know the copy to many people. I have sent it at least to 20 people, you know, like Rex Bernardo, Jim Holland, Hans Peter Fifo, you know, to say some, at least 10 in U.S. and Europe, and many in Latin America, but. That was the only strategy we have, you know, very, very, very primitive strategy. I don't know if there is anything else that we can do.
Yeah, I would think we would want to talk with the Excellence in Breeding platform. We also have scaling up experts, Leonard, who might have some ideas. So
yeah.
This is a huge, huge investment that shouldn't sit on a link on the
yes.
web.
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. And well, we sent it to, I don't know if it was me or you or both, we sent it to Michael Quinn.
We might have to do more than send it to me.
Yeah.
We can discuss more.
Yeah. And I need to send it to Tom Kerrigan and others. But maybe perhaps one sent it. You sent it to Tom? but yeah.
The concept, for example, the concept actually led Salvador. Teach about selection index, talk about not exactly a book because it was not published, but about the software. We are using training, we are using the software, and now we are going to use the book. It's another way in which we can share the information.
And also, I think that Jesus was teaching a course in Chapin, right? On selection indices, because usually there are no courses on selection indices specific. I don't see there is any, but there are a lot of material that deserve to have a course on selection indices, because now I guess our prediction is biometric unity that selection indices will be more and more used. Due to markers, right? Because markers, you usually genomically see what you are selecting. So, but if you want to select for two or three traits, yeah, selection index is a good. This genomic selection index is a good idea. We have done this with simulation with Jesus using genomic selection index.
Yeah, an idea. I mean, of course, this is long term and it requires some work. But I could imagine that, you know, this is so specific, it would interest people in many places. You could imagine a little traveling workshop, for instance, where
yeah,
you
yeah.
two would go on the road and present the book and, you know, talk to specialists all over, I mean, let's say the world, you know, but so
yeah,
that exactly it doesn't stay in one place.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
that's a good idea, and it's basically what Juan was saying, that, you know, they were teaching two courses in Africa, just last week, and you were mentioning Rinse, which is a chapter of the book. So the book got known automatically. Yeah. And sometimes, you know, it might be a little bit intimidating because you open up, but some pages and you see formulas. But it's not.
You mean start for, by the end, the last chapter first?
That's
very much.
Yeah, very much. Or perhaps, you know, start in the middle, at the middle of each chapter, you have the practical examples. But I think that. Still, there are people that they like this theoretical, especially the animal guys. And the animal guys, I know what they're going to say. No, you need to use weights, economic weights. Without economic weights, we don't do anything, and we don't like it. And that's, we have received this constantly, right? But they say, no. Use economic weights, and then use the blobs, which is, use economic weight, you use the blobs, and you have the index there already. Well, yeah, this is somehow true, but then there's no economic weight. For us, for breeders, for plant breeders, there's no economic weight because it's difficult to come up with it. For the animal guys, yes, because they count the number of animals, they count the kilograms of meat, or the liter of meat, and they can develop an economic value. The guys in Africa, you know, Joseph, they say, no, we like to use these weights because we like to emphasize more these diseases in some environments and other diseases in other environments. So we want to weigh this according with our experience, which is perfect. All right. Because they are putting into the, in the way they're putting their experience, which is fine.
So one of the challenges is that, I like the fact that you have examples in the book for how to apply some of the methodologies, but one of the challenges with plant breeders, I mean, you have SAS, you have REU, but most plant breeders at the right time want to sit down and write a call to do that. How easy would it be to build it into a breeding database?
Oh, it's in recent, in this software that we have.
Did you have to get that software included into the enterprise reading software? So you guys definitely need to talk to Tom. I know he wants to talk to you in the next months about, well, more about experimental designs first, but then when we announce this piece also, so that this is included and we, I don't know what you would call it, like a component or a module inside of the enterprise reading system. That way we at least get CGIAR-wise.
Yeah. Because you need to apply, you need to have this specific software. It's more or less economic. You need to have the BGR to run the, well, you don't need the BGR to run the prediction, but you need to have a sort of some extra software to run the genomic prediction, because A is random per se.
Yeah, it's a standalone tool works, but it's actually a lot more work trying to move data from one software to the other, just one place, and they use the tools.
Any other questions?
So we use in China, we use selection index.
So without any questions, we will, before we close the event, we want to thank some of our visitors that came over. The Knowledge Center is open to such events. It's not as formal as like a brown bag, but we would like to encourage colleagues here to have this close environment. You notice the questions are more free-flowing than having someone give you a mic. So we want to encourage colleagues from CIMINT and our colleagues here, our visitors, to please use the Knowledge Center. Share with your colleagues what you're doing, what the progress of your research is. Please, thank you very much for coming,
and congratulations. Sure.